Seasons pray and holy manna will be gathered all around.
Amen. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. This past summer, mostly in the month of July, I have been preaching on the Holy Spirit, that third person of the Trinity, the one that we have traditionally paid the least attention to. Now, I believe the Holy Spirit is God at work. God at work through time, through space, through us. The Holy Spirit comforts us in our grief and disappointment. The Holy Spirit calls us to action, calls us to bring God's kingdom of justice, equity, and peace and compassion to our now, our present, to our communities. The Holy Spirit gives us gifts, the gift of fellowship of our community, but also the gifts that the tools that we need to do the work of kingdom building. The Holy Spirit challenges our assumptions of who God is and what God does and how God's love permeates all created beings, male, female, everyone in between, all ages, all nationalities, no favorites. So the Holy Spirit is in the business of, like the hymn we sang, the business of melting, of molding, filling, and using us to implement God's will in the world. At the end of July, I asked you to offer up ways that the Spirit has been noticed in your life. And I heard from many of you. I hope to offer these testimonies up to you as the "I am well pleased" part of the Spirit's work. The voice that Jesus heard from above after he was baptized. So before the Spirit calls us out into the desert, the crazy fall season of abundance and work, or perhaps you are already in the desert and you need some words of affirmation. You need to hear that God is at work. Hear the affirmations that I received these past few weeks. Affirmations that the Spirit is indeed at work, and in so many different ways. Now, I gave everyone the option of speaking their testimony themselves, but only one took me up on it. So you'll be hearing me translate their words to you, but I encourage you to seek them out and have them tell you themselves as well. Some of you wrote to me with the ways that you experience the Holy Spirit. Molly Simons wrote that she experienced the Holy Spirit as many things, as comforter, as encourager, as guide, and source of blessing, just to name a few. Molly has been on our prayer list a number of times, her husband too, and I find it amazing that she, a widow, surviving not only her husband, but the many years of his care while he declined with Alzheimer's disease, and a cancer survivor, this one resilient, classy lady is always so filled with joy. And I think her reliance on the Holy Spirit is evidence of that joy that we see week after week. Alex Leach, father of two young boys, husband to Brianne, motorcycle enthusiast and gardener, wrote that he experiences the Holy Spirit physically, which makes sense for this hands-on guy who's a member of our session. He wrote, "When I am singing a hymn with words so powerful, I am almost brought to tears. When I watch a movie with a message that resonates so strongly, I feel called to action. This is when I hear the Holy Spirit in my life. The Holy Spirit is also the voice that compels me to make decisions I would not otherwise make. Yes, do this, or you're not too busy that day, do that." The Holy Spirit, he writes, is a constant tug at my heart, and in many situations, I actually feel the tug. It happens a lot in church. No coincidence there, I'm sure. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. There were also stories that you shared with me. Two of you wrote about personal journeys and transformational blessings that can arise after tragedy occurs in your life. Doug Harrison sings in our choir. Many of you would recognize his face, but unless you sing in the choir, you probably don't know who he is. He's quiet, self-contained, a serene kind of guy. He found that the Holy Spirit was working more subtly and in a way that he could not have predicted. Listen to how he describes the Holy Spirit at work in his life after the tragic death of his wife, Corinne. "A year or so after my wife, Corinne, passed, I rejoined my choir in New York City. It was a very warm homecoming, a scene straight out of Hello, Dolly. They all knew the pain we had gone through with Corinne's terrible disease. Shortly after rejoining, I began to notice something. The choir, in my 7-year absence, had become much more quality-driven and had risen to a level that I was not sure that I could keep up with. But I did. And I even found my section leaning on me for support. I am singing things of such complexity and subtleness that I know are far outside my talent. Early on, I became convinced that it was Corinne up there looking out for me and supporting me. Calling that force the Holy Spirit would be very appropriate and descriptive. I definitely feel blessed and lucky to be where I am in life, despite, or more to the point, because of the pain I have gone through." June Waldecker is another quiet sort. Like Doug, you've certainly seen her here in church. Both she and her husband, Jeremy, are on the usher crew. But not many of you know the road that they have traveled. Listen to how she describes the Holy Spirit working in her life. She writes, "After trying to conceive for almost 3 years, I finally became pregnant. I was so overjoyed, thinking God's timing was perfect. Sadly, my first pregnancy was taken away, and I miscarried our first child. The heartbreak was horrible. I was so joyous one moment, and then it was all taken away. I became depressed and angry. My husband and I tried again to conceive. Little did I know that he was still struggling over the loss of our first baby. But we became pregnant again. I thought this time, for sure, it was meant to be. Why would God put us through another miscarriage? Sadly, we miscarried a second time. In the meanwhile, my sister-in-law and my work colleagues were all sharing news of their pregnancies. I hit rock bottom. I was beyond sad and so very angry. One night, I was listening to the hymn, 'It Is Well With My Soul.' I know that it was the Holy Spirit because I couldn't have done this on my own. I prayed to God and surrendered all of my feelings to Him. I told God I couldn't bear the pain anymore. That night, my prayer of anguish turned into a prayer of thanks. I was able to give thanks to God for my miscarriages. I still cannot believe it. Whatever my lot, you have taught me to say, it is well. It is well with my soul. She continues, anyone that knows me knows I am very reserved and private. However, that night I decided to share my story on social media. Moments later, a friend from my past told me that how my testimony had given her hope and lifted her out of her grief as she opened up about her own struggles with fertility and child loss. I was amazed. Out of my grief, I was able to comfort another human and offer hope. How amazing is that? After trusting and keeping my faith in God and always giving thanks for every little thing, every day, this really changed my life. I became pregnant again. Our son was born very premature and spent the first entire 2 months of his life in the NICU. But he was strong from day one. I know God's plan for our son's premature birth was to show everyone around us that knew us, including our own family, the mighty power of God. God performs miracles every day, and our son is proof. He is a testimony of God's love and power. Amen, she writes. I saw little Hayden on the day he was born. He was this big. Have you seen Hayden today? He's huge. He's so big. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Finally, I'd like to share someone's testimony of how she saw the Holy Spirit working on so many levels. But she's the one who said she would read her testimony out loud. Martha.
I like the Bible verses that begin with knock, seek, and ask. They go along nicely with praying to God or beseeching. I am not as keen on listening, receiving, or responding to the Holy Spirit. I believe God is reaching out to us through the Holy Spirit more often than most of us are aware of. And even when we may have an inkling that the Spirit is nudging us in a particular direction, we may ignore it, deny it, or just say, no, not now. However, in the autumn of 2015, the Spirit was not to be ignored. Yes was the only response, the prevalent response, and the joyous response. It all started with Pope Francis, witnessing the refugee crisis in the Middle East with desperate people crossing the Mediterranean Sea to Europe. The Pope called on the church to respond. If each parish took in one family, how many could be rescued, resettled, and given a fresh start? That was the Holy Spirit speaking through the Holy Father. And as chair of mission at FBC, I responded, oh yes, well, maybe, why not? No harm in asking. At the next session meeting, I took David aside and asked to speak to the elders about investigating how to sponsor a refugee family. He said, yes. Later in the meeting, the elders said, yes. When I told the mission committee about my intentions, the members all said, yes. The Holy Spirit was not to be denied this time. For coincidentally, at the November Presbytery meeting, a representative from IRIS was presenting on how congregations could become co-sponsors. Several of us attended and came away knowing that through this agency, we would be able to sponsor a family. This was an official yes. The power of yes continued. Informational meetings were held, committees were formed, tasks were divided, our sponsorship was approved. A core group attended training in New Haven at IRIS. An apartment was found and furnished, and interpreters joined the team. Finally, on August 16, 2016, the Abu Natka family of Syria arrived at JFK after spending 4 years in a refugee camp in Jordan. Yes continued to be the operative word, the positive force in their successful resettlement. 5-year-old Zane had a dental emergency the first week before the family had health care. The dentist we asked for help said yes, as did the oral surgeon. 3 different physicians said yes to doing the family's required physicals and lengthy forms, saving us long hours at Yale New Haven. Everyone the family interacted with, including the crossing guard at the end of the block, who said, "Make sure they have proper boots for the winter," welcomed them and treated them with respect. People from this congregation and New Canaan FPC donated clothes, took them shopping, drove the parents to ESL classes, tutored them at home, and simply befriended them. They have been surrounded by yes. It has now been a year since Haldun, Paula, Hanin, Yemen, Ahmed, and Zane arrived at JFK to begin their life with us in Stanford. There certainly have been problems and bumps in the road as they have adjusted to their new home, learned the language, started school, found employment. Yet reflecting on the experiences of the year past, it must be acknowledged that the Holy Spirit has been the guiding force through all of this. Please pray for God's continued guidance in their lives and our support of them in the year ahead.
Will you sing with me the hymn that we sang just a few minutes ago? It's page 288.
We don't need accompaniment. I think we could just sing it a cappella. What do you think, Jim? Oh, okay. We're singing a cappella. Okay.
Spirit.